Hello and welcome to the Art Class Curator podcast. I am Cindy Ingram, your host and the founder of Art Class Curator and the Curated Connections Library. We're here to talk about teaching art with purpose and inspiration, from the daily delights of creativity to the messy mishaps that come with being a teacher. Whether you're driving home from school or cleaning up your classroom for the 15th time today, take a second, take a deep breath, relax those shoulders, and let's get started. Hey everybody, it's Cindy Ingram, and today for the podcast, I actually have a re-release from one of my very first episodes. And the reason I'm doing this is, one, that I have been sick. So I wasn't able to, I got behind on my podcast interviews. You might be able to kind of still hear the sickness in my voice, but I've been sick for like a week and a half. No COVID, everything's fine. But I really love this episode with Michael Linson from Smart Classroom Management. He has such amazing insight into effective classroom management, how to form relationships with your students, and I think that, you know, for any art teacher, he is the go-to person for classroom management for art teachers, specials teachers, and things like that. So here we go. Here is my interview with Michael Linson. Today's guest literally wrote the book on classroom management for art teachers. It's Michael Linson of smartclassroommanagement.com. One of the things I love about Michael's strategy is how his whole plan starts with a classroom climate of trust. He knows that when students and teachers respect one another, they can work together to create a fun environment and develop a deep love of learning. Good classroom management is vital because it allows us the freedom to teach and gives students the freedom to learn. And now I'm thrilled to welcome Michael to the podcast. All right. Well, I'm so pleased to welcome Michael Linson to the Art Class Curator podcast. Welcome, Michael.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Now, I know most art teachers know about your work because you run the website smartclassroommanagement.com and are helping a lot of people there. Can you give us sort of a rundown of your experiences and your background with your site and your teaching?
Well, I started the website 9 years ago, just in an effort to help teachers because I saw so many struggling around me. And so the first kind of part of my career, I really focused on my classroom and what I was doing, and then just wanted to branch out and help others enjoy teaching as much as I was.
Yeah, I think that when reading through a lot of what you talk about, it's really exciting to hear you talk about how much you enjoy teaching, because I feel the same way. It's like when you have a well-run classroom, like it's fun, and the kids have fun, and the teacher has fun, and it doesn't have to be this like totally terribly stressful thing. It can be fun.
You took the words and take the words right out of my mouth.
Yeah.
It's absolutely true. You know, I do love teaching, and it's okay to have fun. And there's a way that we can have fun and be effective teachers also.
Oh, so what is your number one tip for having to create that in that fun environment for a teacher? We'll just start there. What's the first thing you think of?
Be an expert in classroom management. That's first and foremost, and should be the number one thought in your mind going into every day. If you do that well, you'll be an effective teacher, and you'll love your job a lot more.
Yeah, I could not agree with that more, because I kind of came into teaching, I taught college first, and you don't really have to do classroom management when teaching college. If they don't want to be there, they just won't come, you know?
Yes.
But, and then I did a master's in art education where we just talked theory all day. And then I get into the classroom and I had no idea what to do. I knew I was a good teacher, but I had no idea. I mean, I read the Harry Wong book, you know, that they always give you, and that's all I had. And oh man, did I struggle with that. So I think you're right. You can't be an effective teacher. You can't have fun teaching unless you have a well-run classroom. You just can't do it. So what are your number one tips for having a well-run classroom?
Having a classroom management plan, for sure. One that protects your freedom to teach, and the freedom protects the rights of your students to learn and enjoy being in your class. And so I think of it as like a protective wall or barrier with the freedom and all the good stuff inside, and we keep all the bad stuff and disruptions on the outside. And then consistently following it.
Yeah. That's
the kind of basic keys.
You can have the plan all you want, but if you don't follow through. So what makes up a good classroom management plan?
Well, And here's the thing, is it critically important, right? A classroom management plan, but it's a small part of effective classroom management, just a small part of it. And so the rules are, can be very boring, but I like to tell teachers to visualize, kind of sit down and think about all the behaviors that they've had that disrupt their classroom and write them down and use those to come up with a set of rules that cover all of those behaviors. We do offer classroom management plans on the website, and so with examples of rules that you can use that have been proven effective. Mm-hmm. However, it really comes down to making sure that they cover every potential misbehavior that can happen in your classroom. And then as far as consequences, they're even less important than the rules. And I don't mean to say that they're not important. It's just that what they are is less important than you actually following them. Mm-hmm. And so there isn't a magic set of consequences. And I get that question a lot in a lot of emails saying, you know, can you help me configure some consequences? And they really don't matter a lot what they are. It just matters that we follow them exactly and to a T.
Oh, yeah. I think that's a good, because I think, you know, everything you read, everything I read when I first started teaching, it was switched. You know, we have the rules and you put them up on the wall and you talk about the rules, but then it's the consequences that really take up a lot more of your time, and you teach the consequences more and you teach, you know, all of that. It seems like, I don't know, I'm speaking for my own personal, like, struggling first few years, but yeah. The rules were just, I don't know that I actually referred to the rules all that often. Probably should have.
Yeah, it's really, really important to define those rules for your students, because when they do misbehave, they should know that it's a choice they're making. Mm-hmm. In other words, there shouldn't be any doubt what constitutes breaking them or what constitutes abiding by them. And it's really important those students really, really are clear on what those rules are.
So how do you teach the rules?
Modeling is the most effective way. And when I say modeling, I mean modeling in an extremely detailed manner. So you want to pretend that you're one of your students and actually sit in a chair and model those behaviors that break each one of your rules. And then also model what following those rules looks like. So the students know exactly, have a really clear picture of what that is. And then you give your students a chance to model for each other and to practice in groups and as a whole class until there's no doubt what those mean. And so I like to say a lot that it's really important that you lay everything out on the table, lay all your cards out on the table. These are the rules and these are the consequences and that's what they are. And that goes a long way towards separating you, the person who's enforcing those rules and consequences, and the rules and misbehavior themselves. And what I mean by that is we don't want those students to think that we're doing it out of malice or because we're angry at them. We're doing it because we're doing what we said we were going to do, and we're protecting their right to learn and enjoy being in the class.
Oh, I love that, because, you know, I'm thinking about a student who maybe like blurts out a lot or something like that. The student has seen you like jumping around, blurting out, like pretending to do that. They'll see how ridiculous it looks, the teacher doing it. And cause some little self-reflection there and be like, yeah, it's not a very productive thing. I can see how them seeing you do that could be really beneficial.
Yeah, it's really powerful and it's true. The behaviors that you model, and it's okay to have fun modeling them and to exaggerate a little bit modeling them. And when you can model the exact same things that you see in your students, and the more experience you have, the more you're able to do that. Yeah. It's incredible. Those behaviors that you model, you rarely see them actually doing it. And they do and are able to see the absurdity of how disruptive those things can be.
Yeah, I can imagine you putting a student up at the front of the room and having them try to tell the class a story, and then you sit there and flip a water bottle over and over again. Yeah. Like, and they'll be like, this is really frustrating. I'm trying to tell the story and all I'm hearing is this water bottle flipping. I think that's
fun to teach too.
Yeah. You know?
It's all teaching. And a lot of teachers tell me, well, gosh, I hate teaching classroom management. But it's just like teaching anything else. And you can have just as much fun with it as you have with any other lesson. And yeah, I love having a student act as the teacher. I think that's really powerful also.
Yeah, that's fun. And yeah, it's teaching just how to be a citizen of the world and how to have consideration for other people. And it's still worthwhile, whether or not it's, you know, teaching the subject matter content, it's teaching them to be good people.
That's true. Good. Yeah. For sure.
Awesome. Okay. So you model the rules very heavily. And now with an art teacher who doesn't have a lot of time with her students, how do you manage that balance, the time spent between teaching those rules and those procedures versus teaching the content, especially at the beginning?
Well, you would do an overview and you'd move a little faster in that overview. But each day, if let's say you have, you know, 45 to an hour with your students, you may spend just 10 or 15 minutes a day on classroom management each day for the first, you know, 3-4 weeks of the school year. And you'd have little mini lessons to teach in detail each of those rules a little bit more specifically each week. And it's something you can extend with some classes. It's something you may have to extend, and you may have to do that for, you know, a couple months and even revisit it. And I actually recommend that no matter what you're teaching, that you're constantly reviewing those rules and you're doing those detailed lessons about specific things that you're seeing in your classroom.
Yeah, I think that's such a good point, because I'm thinking about, like, you get stressed out as a teacher and then you start to let little things slide. And then by, you know, the middle of the year, by the end of the year, the kids are running the show, and then you've lost them. And, you know, if you were, you know, take a check-in with yourself every month or so, think about the class, think about what's going on, and then just take a 10-minute, 15-minute break and with the students, be like, we're going to review not blurting out today. You know?
Yeah, it really is all about the teacher. It's not the class. It's being consistent as a teacher and being prepared and understanding. And we can talk about this a little bit, but understanding how to create leverage in a way that makes those consequences, even if they're just a warning and maybe a 10-minute timeout, to make those powerful experiences for the students.
Yeah, I think that's good. Last year at my school, we implemented this discipline system. My headmaster has a classroom management website too, actually, but he implemented this system, and the consequence really at the beginning was just like writing your name on a form. It was like your discipline form, and that's all it was. All they had to do was write their name, but there was so much power associated with that they did not want to write their name in that book, and they did not want to, you know, to own up to what they had done. So I saw like a lot of instant change in a lot of these kids. And it wasn't that the consequence was anything severe. It was really just writing your name, you know? But yeah, when you develop a plan.
Yeah. And the student is, by writing their name and by taking themselves, standing up and taking themselves to timeout, it's an additional accountability. They're taking responsibility, you know, for doing it. They're acknowledging their misbehavior by doing those things.
Yeah, some of them would try to bargain, you know, I'll do a detention instead of writing my name in the book. And like, you would rather, you know, sit in a 30-minute detention than to write your name down. So yeah, creating that leverage, I think, is important. And owning up to, teaching them to own up to their mistakes. So what do you think about, I know there's a lot of consequences of like students reflecting on their behavior, like filling out a reflection form or whatever. What are your thoughts on those?
Yeah, I don't like them.
Oh, I don't either. I'm glad to hear you say that. I hate them.
Yeah, not only are
tell me why.
Well, they're a pain for teachers, of course. The other thing is they take students away from what's going on in the classroom. So, you know, I believe students sitting in timeout instead of filling out a reflection form, they need to be responsible and accountable to what's going on in the classroom. So they need to listen and pay attention. And that way, as teachers, we don't have to bring them up to speed individually. They should be, in fact, they're required before leaving timeout that they have to sit and listen and be ready when they come back to class. But the other reason is that forcing students to reflect, as you can't really force someone to reflect, and it can cause students to just write what they think you want to hear.
Mm-hmm.
Or a lot of times, even more often, they'll excuse their behavior. So they can just write on the reflection form. They can point the finger elsewhere or give reasons or excuses why they misbehave. And they won't truly reflect.
They'll write. I've seen students write, well, this teacher is picking on me, or, you know, they're not doing anything productive on those flexion sheets.
The idea and a lot of what I teach on my website is getting those students to reflect naturally. And a lot of that comes down to how you enforce those consequences and how you teach those rules and how much they enjoy being in your classroom. And how they see you as, when you're enforcing consequences, as truly just protecting their right to learn and enjoy school rather than any creating any animosity or friction between you. And those things, when they can't point the finger at you, okay, so they can't, you've removed that possibility. They can't be angry at you. And then they know exactly where the line was and they crossed it anyway. So they know that they broke a rule. So you take those two things, and then that student sits in timeout, or they're just given a warning, they naturally reflect on their behavior and then choose not to do it again. They like to improve. When they love being in your classroom, the last thing they want to do is to be separated from it.
Yeah, and I've noticed too, one of my classroom management strategies is just getting students to love me. And so I'm just extra charming, extra nice. Like, I mean, I'm firm in the rules and the concept, you know, but I just like to get them to love me and love my class. And so they don't want to upset me. And they know that they know I'm not going to do something and it's unfair because they've seen me model that, you know? So I think that is such a good point that, you know it's not the teacher. When they're acting up. And so that's when you can automate your classroom management in a way that you remove the blame from you. And it's just like, this is what we do. This is the rules. Then you're naturally I love that. Naturally teaching them to reflect. And they don't know they're reflecting. It doesn't really matter that they know it.
Out of your hands.
Yeah.
You did your job and you move on and teach and things, that method just works.
Yeah.
It just works. And like you said, when you're getting them to love you, and it's in a small way selfish, but it's so much fun. And relationships are just so wonderful and powerful.
Yeah. It's like the importance of developing strong relationships with your students, being passionate about teaching them, being passionate about like the teaching process, and being passionate about your content. Like those, I think, are some of the most important things to running an effective classroom. Because when you develop those, then the rest of it can be a little bit easier because you remove that drama, them not wanting to be there. And people always say to me, and I hate when they say this to me, they're like, oh, they're good for you because you teach art.
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, they're good for me because I love what I'm doing and I love them. And, you know, so it's,
or
I hate when I hear
you're so lucky. You have such a great class. And
yeah,
you want to say, well, have you noticed that they're great every year? I sure get lucky, don't I?
Oh yeah. It drives me nuts. But yeah. Hopefully. Well, there was this one magical teacher at my school last year, and I loved watching her because her students were so well behaved and she was so calm. And I tried to channel her sometimes because, it wasn't that her class, like they probably would have been bad for anybody else, but they were so good for her. And then when they would come to art, and I wasn't the art teacher, I only taught the older kids and she was third grade, but I was in the same classroom. And she, you know, when they came in, like they were good for the art teacher too, because they were just so well trained to be good everywhere they went. So,
and her influence extended beyond the four walls of the classroom, which is possible.
Yeah. I think that's
that, you know, what can I do to make sure that they're good when they go out to PE? And the answer is you have to be better. You know, the better you are and the more they respect you and the words that you say, the more you're able to extend your influence, even at home doing homework, you know?
Yeah. So what about a teacher, an elementary art teacher will teach, I taught, seven classes a day, and it was every 6 days. So it was like 750 kids and, you know, six classes per grade level. And so each class was so different because, you know, that influence, of course, was extending from the teacher that they came from too. What do you recommend for, I mean, is there anything else to mention about that other than what we've already said?
Well, it's hard to build individual relationships, right? Yeah. When you're a specials teacher, that's the big challenge, because you may not learn most of their names, you know, by the end of the first quarter. But the thing of it is we were talking about, you know, you were saying how, you know, one of your primary objectives is to make sure that the students love you and enjoy you and love coming to your classroom. And so that's how you build relationships, is that you draw them to you. So you may not know them very well, but they can still love you because of your personality and, you know, the way you look at them and say hello to them and how much fun you have during your lessons. Yeah. That's how you build that leverage rather than one-on-one relationships.
And even little comments like, you're wearing a UT shirt today, and I went to the University of Texas. You know, I'm not saying I like your UT shirt, or, you know, they're just hearing me acknowledge something about them. And so they feel like they're seen, even if I don't remember their name for the next 6 weeks, you know.
For sure. And so they, you know, that's really the focus of art teachers that see so many students is just to make sure that you're creating a classroom that they love being part of. That's where you're going to get your leverage from.
And I do think it's important to learn their names as quickly as you can. A lot of teachers don't, but I feel like you have to if you're going to have any difference on them, and you do the best you can to learn it as fast as you can. I used to teach at a museum, and I would teach the just tours. I would always memorize their names like in the first few minutes. It was good because then they would leave and I didn't have to keep remembering them, but I developed really good strategies for like staring a kid down and remembering their name. But they always felt so excited that I knew their name. So
do you use like an anchor system? Like
yeah, it would be like their hair. It'd be their hair or their, you know, or the color of their shirt or something, because then it would be like 1 hour. But I always had a problem with kids too that would change their hair. Like when I was teaching elementary, if they changed their hair, I would get totally confused because I'm like, no, wait, I had you memorized because of your hair. And seating charts to help and that sort of thing. I did find that putting their name, like putting little name placards on the tables helped during class, like felt that I knew their name. When they left, I had no idea. So I actually stopped doing that because I relied on it as a crutch too much.
I love those classroom teachers who send the students with name tags.
Oh, yes.
Isn't that wonderful when they do that?
Okay, so excellent. Now, when you talk about timeouts as a consequence, do you do that up until high school, or how old do you say do you go with timeouts?
Definitely sixth grade, and then seventh grade, between seventh and eighth grade or so, depending on your school, there's I would recommend a transition. So I think they become less effective, and there's also stigma. But, you know, by then, and they're starting to feel like they're a little too old for it. And I kind of agree at that point.
What do you do at that age level in high school?
Well, at high school, I recommend, and it's sort of a big question. I do have a plan, an e-guide based on a plan for high school students and upper middle school students, but it's pretty detailed, but it involves a student's earning listening and participation points. And it can be a part of their grade. It can be really effective. I recommend warnings in the form of eye contact.
Yeah.
And asking students to stop. And so you model that what that means when you make eye contact with a student, that is an official warning. And then modeling and defining when you ask them to stop a particular behavior, that is, they are going to lose a point, and that is an official warning. And then as a second consequence, stopping them out on their way out and letting them know where they stand, not having a lecture with them or a pep talk or anything like that, but just giving them information. Okay, this is what happened today. These are the points that you lost. If I see this behavior tomorrow, here's the next thing that happens, which could lead to a detention, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But I don't
recommend. We'll link to your e-guide down in the show notes of this episode, because I think that sounds awesome. I'm really enjoying talking to you, because everything you say, I'm like, oh, I do that. It's just making me feel better about myself. Oh, I have a clipboard, and it has a seating chart on it, and then under each name, there's 10 little squares. And then during a classroom discussion, or if they're doing like a bell ringer, I'm just walking around like putting check marks that they're doing their work. And if they're not focused, I'll put an X. And then sometimes I'll just stare a kid down and like look at my clipboard and look at them, and they're just like focus. And you know, it's just a little thing. And then they're not getting singled out in the class by, you know, I'm like, I'm writing an X next to your name. You know, they're knowing that that's happening, but it's not sort of being broadcast class. And it input, and I take those, and that's their weekly grade. You know, when I fill up the squares is when I input it. But
that, you know, good teachers, when you go and observe good teachers, they themselves observe a lot. Mm-hmm. And from afar, they watch their students, and as their students are fulfilling the objective that they taught, and all, you know, they usually have a little clipboard taking notes or jotting points, evaluating their students and their strengths and weaknesses.
Yeah. And I think, you know, another thing is just moving around the classroom. You know, if you stay at the front of the room, you're going to miss all those kids in the back. But if you're walking around and you're moving, you know, as you're teaching, they know that you're looking and you're watching, and they know that you see everything, and you make eye contact with each kid at one point during that lesson. Mm-hmm. They know that you're paying attention. And mm-hmm. I think that goes a long way into stopping any potential, you know, getting off task or, you know, secretly trying to get on their phones and stuff like that, that mm-hmm. they know you're paying attention. Okay. So what about rewards? Do you like rewards?
Don't like them. Don't use them. Don't recommend them at all. They effectively snuff out intrinsic motivation.
Yeah.
And they work against what you're trying to do in creating a classroom that is itself the reward. Actual learning and participating and be part of something bigger than themselves is the reward. And that's what we're trying to do. And we're not trying to get through the day. We're trying to change students for a lifetime. And so rewards interfere with.
Yeah, I experiment a little bit with Class Dojo, which I know can be really good, like the little point system. But I did find that, you know, they got a certain prize at a certain number of points. And some of the kids were motivated by that, and they did want to do better. But they became obsessed about the number of points that they were getting. And I'm like, you should be obsessed about what we're learning, not constantly asking me how many points you have. Like, it got to be really annoying in that way. And I think it was helpful for some students, but other students were just naturally just getting a lot of points and just doing their work, and they didn't really care. And it just became more of a hassle, I think, more than anything. But I do see that.
Well, and you're also teaching them that what they're doing, what you're rewarding them for, you're telling them that it's work and it's deserving of being paid. Right. And we shouldn't look at learning that way as just drudgery and work. But that's what we tell them when we reward them for it. And the research shows that you can get them to do something with a reward, but the next time they'll be less motivated to do it because it feels like work. And then, of course, you have to keep continuing to increase the rewards. And so they're not good for your classroom, but they're also just a giant headache for teachers. And when you get rid of them, it's incredibly liberating.
And then you have to worry about fairness too. And then that's a whole thing.
If you're going to give them, then you better be honest about it. And so, which means there are some students who may not be receiving rewards, or many of them. And so it really confuses things for students.
I watched a video recently, and I don't know if you follow James Wedmore. He has a business podcast, but he did a video recently about how schools are teaching kids to be in like an employee mindset, that, you know, you work and you get paid and you go home at the end of the day and you're done. And that we're not necessarily teaching kids to take ownership of their learning or be creative or to think outside the box. And I think what you're saying with rewards is it's teaching them to be in an employee mindset, that, you know, you do this because you have to do it to get paid. You don't do it because of the joy of doing it and the joy of solving problems, the joy of learning. You do it because you're going to get something from it.
It becomes a cold exchange. Your classroom becomes just, you know, you're being manipulative also. It doesn't feel good, you know. Somewhere inside, you know, you cringe when you do that. And there are some students who are offended by it. Some that already have a strong internal self-worth, and they'll cringe. And inside they're saying, you know, I can't be bought, you know.
Yeah, I was one of those.
I wrote this essay. By you giving me this, it's almost like you're taking credit also, but I did this for myself. You know, I'm doing this for my own. So we want to encourage that.
Yeah. Okay. So how do we encourage students to develop that intrinsic motivation?
We send the message that the classroom is worth coming to, right? Mm-hmm. And so we're fair with our rules and consequences. So we're straight with them. We lay everything out on the table with that stuff. But then we... Those are the expectations that we want from our students, but we have to do our part. So that's their responsibility, right? But then we have to make it worth their while. We have to make them coming to the classroom worth it. We want them to mm-hmm. love it, can't wait to get there. And so we do that through our personality and our fun and our humor, our good humor. And that's where a big part of it comes from. But it also comes from being prepared and having good, clear, objective, and interesting lessons. So that's
yeah, I think, and when you have a good classroom management plan in place, you're having less parent phone calls and mm-hmm. letters home, and you're having to have less students in your room for detentions and all of that. And then you have more time to create better lessons. So it's just a win-win, I think, all the way around. It all stems back to running that classroom in a really straightforward and planned and deliberate and intentional way.
It frees you to be that fun teacher.
Yeah.
Because when you rely exclusively on that plan, on that contract that you made with your students, on the promise in the beginning of the school year, you promised them that you would follow it, you know, or don't have a classroom management plan, you know, but you promise that you follow it, and you do, you let it do the dirty work. And so when you don't have to glare and you don't have to try to convince students to behave, you don't have to lecture or pep talk or any of that kind of stuff, it frees you to really enjoy teaching, and it frees you to build really powerful relationships with those students that they'll remember, you know, forever, and be the students that come back and see you even
oh, I love it.
20 years later.
Yeah. Well, that word promise is so powerful to think about in terms of the, you can even like put that, you know, when you're teaching it, put that up on the rules poster. Like, we promise as a class, yeah. I promise as a teacher, you know, that we're going to do this. And I think that that is such a powerful word and a powerful bond that you're creating, and that it's, you have to follow it because you promised you would do it. I love that.
Oh. That's just it. It's soft pressure on you every single day when you make that promise. To actually do what you said you were going to do, to be consistent, is to promise that you will. You look your students in the eyes and you tell them, I promise, follow these rules exactly as they're written. And I promise to never berate you, yell at you, glare at you, make you feel bad.
Oh, and that's it. You can even make yourself a little mantra. Put it on your computer screen or on your desk every day yeah. and say, I promise today I will
yeah.
do the things.
Yeah. You know, if you think about it, that's how students are going to see it anyway. If you tell them, okay, this is our classroom management plan, this is what mm-hmm. we're doing, and then you don't do it, you're going to have a hard time building relationships. You're going to have a hard time getting their attention. You're going to have a hard time keeping their attention and having good listening, because they're just not going to trust you. They're not going to trust yeah. anything else you have to say right off the bat.
Yeah. It's like with parenting. And they always say, you know, if you threaten something, you have to follow through, because they're going to learn that you can't. Yeah. You know, that you don't, you can't, you're not trustworthy. Yeah. So you have to follow through. And I think sometimes it's easy, or as a teacher, just in general, to not follow through because you've got too much going on and you're like, well, okay, I'll deal with this later. And then you don't. And then you've lost their trust and you've lost that leverage that you talk about. That's right. Hard. Stick with it. But if you develop this all plan and teach it correctly, it won't be as hard. So do work at the beginning.
It makes it a lot easier with promising, but it also mm-hmm. it makes it easier when you are a referee rather than a judge. Mm. And when you know you've removed that, you know, so you know that you're not going to, you know, raise your voice and try to get into battles with students, it makes it pretty easy. And when students see that it's just, you're just doing what you said you were going to do, there's no animosity, you know, they get it. They know that they're sent to timeout because they've crossed the line and they
yeah.
to be there and reflect on why they're there.
Excellent. Well, I think this is so beneficial, and I wish I would have had you to tell me all of this when I started teaching, because that would have been all good information to have. So hopefully we helped some new teachers, especially with this one. But I think anybody. Okay, well, thank you so much. And I have a question that I ask everybody at the end of every episode. And I don't know, you're not an art teacher, so you might, I don't know what kind of answer you have to this. But the question is, which artwork changed your life? Do you have an artwork that changed your life? It could be music or theater or movies or something too.
Well, I'm not sure it changed my life, but I saw Matisse's dance in my early 20s at the Hermitage Museum in St. Petersburg, Russia. And it was the first piece of art that really made me appreciate art and want to be an enthusiastic museum goer. It was like an aha moment, like, okay, yes. now I get it. Yeah. And I returned to that room with those dancing figures, you know, again and again.
Yeah, it's a good one when you want to go back and you're like, oh, I just got to see it one more time. But that one's really big, isn't it? I haven't been there. Yeah. Oh, yeah, and the movement of it. I love this question because every time I ask this question, you can see something about the person in the artwork that they chose. And I love that you're a PE teacher and that you chose that one because it has, you know, all the movement and it's very simple. But I love it. All the lines, the bodies and everything, like how it flows.
Awesome.
I love that. Yes, that's awesome. Okay. I always can see some sort of connection with like what you are now versus what that artwork was. So
that's cool.
Awesome. I'm glad you had an answer for that. That's excellent. Okay. So thank you so very much for joining me today.
My pleasure.
I know you were very helpful and I will link to your books. He has tons of books online. What's your website again? Let's tell us like your favorite social media.
SmartClassroomManagement.com and then Facebook Smart Classroom Management.
Okay. And then you have e-guides and books and all the things. And there's one specifically for special teachers. So
yes, the orange book.
Yes. No, I know exactly what the cover looks like. I see it, you know, all the time. So awesome. Well, I'll link to all of that in the show notes. And I'm sure that you will have some more visitors to your website because I know I want to go and read more too. So
sounds good, Cindy. Thank you.
All right. Awesome. Thank you so much.
If your art appreciation classes were anything like mine, they happened in dark rooms with endless slides and boring lectures. Art in the dark. But art appreciation doesn't have to turn into nap time for your students. Start connecting your students to art with powerful class discussions. It can be intimidating to start talking about art with students, so teachers always want to know what they should say. The real question is what you should ask. You can get 82 questions to ask about almost any work of art for free on the Art Class Curator blog. The free download includes the list of questions, plus cards that you can cut out and laminate to use again and again. These versatile questions can be used in everything from bell ringers to group activities to critiques. Just go to artclasscurator.com/questions to get your free copy today. Thank you so much for listening to the Art Class Curator podcast. If you like what you hear, please subscribe and give us an honest rating on iTunes to help other teachers find us and hear these amazing art conversations and art teacher insights. Be sure to tune in next week for more art inspiration and curated conversations.